Thank you very much, Lajos, and thank you very much to the organizers of this interesting conference and the city of Skopje for the magnificent place where we are having the meeting. My major point here is to tell you the message that answering the question you planned at the beginning, how we design the future. My answer is we cannot continue as we did in the past. We cannot continue doing as we are doing in the present. We need an alternative approach. Let's see some introductory aspects and then the alternative approaches we have. It was told to us early in the afternoon that people is agglomerating in cities and in bigger and bigger cities, not homogeneously all around the world. Faster in America, faster in less developed countries than in most developed countries, but the number of people living in bigger and bigger cities is increasing. And I want to remark, in addition to the increase of the population globally, I want to remark one aspect. This is happening also because the intensive migratory dynamics from rural to urban areas. And this has two side views. There is a pushing factor, moving people away from rural areas that we don't need to review. Wars, climate change, lack of job opportunities are some of these factors, but there are also pulling factors attracting people to cities. More opportunities, maybe more security. Well, a number of factors. There are two side views. And this takes us to the fact that there are positive and negative impacts of this rural to urban migration. There are positive impacts in urban areas. There are more people working, natural human capital. Well, usually with low salaries and in not very good conditions. But there are also negative impacts as overcrowding and not so good conditions for many people living in the cities, particularly for those who migrate in not very good conditions. And there are also negative impacts and positive impacts in the rural areas from where the people move to the big cities. Negative impacts are that the structure of the population does not continue, it's this structure. Elder people accumulates, young people, those with most capacity move to the urban areas. There is a decrease in the productivity because those remaining in the rural areas do not have so much capacity to maintain the work. It's necessary, but there are also positive aspects in the rural areas of this rural to urban migration. In the rural areas, they receive money from those who migrated to the urban areas, and they receive some cultural aspects as that it's necessary to innovate. It's necessary to do some entrepreneurship, otherwise you will not survive in the rural areas. In any case, I want to remark one global aspect which is very interesting. The last report of the, the last report of the OECD organization is telling us that a significant amount of the gross product of the world, and that varies from country to country, is contributed by people migrating from the rural areas to urban areas and doing that at different spatial scales, locally, regionally, intercontinentally, globally. So the recommendation from this just economic point of view, and it's not only that one, is that public authorities as well as employees and employer organization in destination countries should therefore prioritize protecting the rights of immigrants and preventing all forms of discrimination and racism. And there is a direct relationship between the contribution of migrants in urban areas to the economy of the place and the level standard of living of these people in these countries, in these cities. So as better the standard of living of migrants in the places where they go, better contribution to the economy of that of those places. Anyway, we have some differences between urban and rural areas. Urban areas host very dynamic economies. We have heard about that during the meeting today. Urban areas are sources of environmental impacts also and develop intensive social relationships. And rural areas try to keep traditional economic structures, provide ecosystem services, and social structures are based on traditional customs, and they keep traditional knowledge. If we analyze the differences between urban and rural areas, in general, there are not big differences globally. We need to analyze these differences with more detail. And for example, there are not big differences between rural and urban areas in the US, United States of America. You see the numbers, rural, urban, or employed, there are not big differences. Poverty rate, there are not big differences. Household incomes, there are not big differences. We need to look for more detailed analysis. Is, for example, where the people living in the cities recently moved to the cities compared to those who have been there for some time, and then we have more differences. But there are some places where the gap between rural and urban areas is clear. For example, in China, these are number of people in attending the school, a relative number, and this is urban, the black one, and gray, the rural. So it's a gap, either you consider primary school, secondary school, and so on, until universities. So depending on the place, and depending the area, and depending on the factor or character you analyze, you will see gaps. If you analyze the data globally, you will miss, you will lose those differences. Okay, then the point, my point is, how cities are planning the future? Are they doing that in a sustainable way? And to answer that, we did an analysis of the strategic plan of 33 cities from around the world, covering a wide range of inhabitants and a wide range of population density. And we realized that only 18 out of these 33 cities are using indicators, something to be measured in their strategic plans. So only 50% or 55% of these 33 cities, whose strategic plans we review, are using indicators, which is not very good news, because in order to have a good strategic plan, you need something to measure. And in addition, the sustainability theory tells that you should have a well-balanced distribution of issues, of topics, in this case indicators, between the three components of sustainability, the environmental one, the economic one, and the social one. And looking at the 379 indicators used by these cities using indicators, we realize that most of the indicators they use are attending social aspects, but not so many for environmental aspects and not so many for economic aspects. So most of the cities we were reviewing the strategic plans are not following the triple bottom line of sustainability. Let's see some of the differences between these the cities, their strategic plans. Of these 18 strategic plan of cities using indicators, only five have a number of indicators which are relatively well balanced between environmental, social, and economic aspects. These five here. The number of indicators of any of these economic, social, environmental issues are in these cities are between 20% and 60%. For social, 20%, 60%. All these follow within these ranges. And these are some of these cities following this strategy. A well-balanced distribution of indicators between the three aspects considered as a sustainable approach for planning the city future. The others are using more of one of these aspects than the others. For example, Tokyo is not using economic indicators, probably because Tokyo, everything is economy, and they don't need to follow up how they manage with economy. But it's not well-balanced strategic plan for that city compared to the others. I am not telling that it's a bad strategic plan, but it's not following the route of sustainable development if they are following to the results of these indicators to modify or review the future. Okay, we also wanted to compare this strategic plan with some key aspects of the economy, the social aspect of the environmental status of these cities. And we realized, and we used three proxies for this respective economy, social, or environmental status. The gross income of the cities, the human development index of the cities, that I don't have time to detail now, and one of the environmental characteristics is the density of particles of size suspended in the air. And it's curious, but those cities which have strategic plans with a well-balanced distribution of indicators between the three pillars of sustainability are those with better gross income, high human development index, and better air characteristics. So it seems that those cities with good living conditions have better capacity to prepare better strategic plans. Okay, now let's see how planning rural systems is working. We passed the city. Cities are not doing very well. In fact, I have bad news for you, or at least one of my major points of view is that cities are unsustainable. Nothing in a city, in any of the pictures I presented, neither material in the cities or the pictures we observed during the day in that screen, come from a city. Water, raw materials, wood, anything, glass, come from rural areas where the minerals, the natural produce comes. So now let's see how rural systems were planned and which alternatives we have. In the past, and in different places in the world, until mid last century and a few decades more, the rural plans were focusing on only one sector aspect, agriculture or infrastructures, transport, but separated one from the other. And many of them were subsidizing people to avoid poverty. And then there was a change after the Rio meeting in 1992, and taking more consideration of environmental aspects. Everyone wanted to have protected areas in the world, or more protected areas. But nowadays, after the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment from the United Nations in 2005, there is another consideration, another aspect to take into account that was mentioned early in the afternoon by Charles Boros-Morthy. That was the ecosystem services provided to cities by rural areas. He was talking and giving some examples of the importance of water provided by rural areas with good forest to cities. And I am going to present an example on how we could plan rural territories considering this aspect of provision of ecosystem services from rural areas to a territory, and to cities and to our territory in general. Let me skip this slide and consider this watershed, which is in some part in Spain, in southwest Europe, a small area, about 1,000 square kilometers, very much depopulated. Most of the people move from the villages to the city. There is not any big city there, no more than 2,000 people. And with all the characteristics of these depopulated areas, which are very frequent in all around the world. And for example, in Europe, in North Europe, there are large areas where the population density is less than 10 people per square kilometers. It's the same in my country. And let's consider that this is the area we are studying. The present state, most of the area is occupied for agricultural purposes, very low productivity, very low incomes. It's dry area, not irrigated. There are abandoned fields which were cultivated in the past and not anymore now because people move out. And there are riparian forests, another forest, which represent a very small part of the territory. We can project scenarios for the future and see how much the ecosystem services are provided by this area. And the present state will be one of these possibilities, but let's consider different scenarios. One of these could be to intensify the agriculture, to intensify the area dedicated to agriculture from abandoned fields to move to that and keep the forest area. Another one could be a mixture of conservation and production to increase a little bit the area dedicated to agriculture and also dedicate some of the abandoned fields to forests or natural ecosystems. And let's see what happens with respect to provision of ecosystem services. In the current conditions, and here we have a rose with petals, and every petal, every point here represents ecosystem services, then in the current situation, most of it dedicated to agriculture, only production is very high, food and raw materials, mineral materials. And one of these is regulating a nutrient. But the rest, cultural services, climate change regulation, others are very low contributed by this distribution. But let's see what happens in the two scenarios we projected, which are the increase in agriculture, which is this one. Only this is increased. The production of food is increased in this scenario, but the others decrease, providing other regulating services, cultural services, is decreased a lot. Biodiversity conservation is decreased. So this scenario is not sustainable. And the other one, conservation and production, just to mention this possibility, in this case, this line here provides a more balanced contribution of ecosystem services. So this tool of evaluating ecosystem services is a good tool to plan the future. What parts of the territory could be dedicated to different objectives? Increasing the agricultural production, for example, increasing regulation of nutrients, increasing cultural aspect, increasing recreational aspect. This is an interesting tool to plan the development of rural areas. Let me skip this one. And as I said at the beginning, we cannot continue with the dynamics we follow until now. If we plan the development of cities focusing only in the cities, we will forget about rural areas and the gap between them will be the same. If we focus only on rural areas, we will focus on sectoral aspects, which is mostly demanded. Because as said just 1 minute ago, they don't have the capacity that is in the cities. So my proposal is to establish a partnership between rural and urban areas. In fact, they don't live separated. They live physically close to each other. They function collectively because there are movements of materials and people from one place to another. So rural areas could provide natural capital and ecosystem services, and urban areas may contribute the economic dimension and human capital. I don't have time now to explain what are the possibilities for this partnership between urban and rural areas. In fact, I call that rurban, and I don't have time to mention the strategic pillars to follow that way of planning together the rural and urban areas. This will be most probably written and detailed in the written text that we are preparing as a publication from this conference. But I only want to mention, in addition to the five aspects that Felipe already mentioned, that in order to establish a good partnership for planning rural, not rural separated from urban, but rural systems, we need to establish a good confidence between both of them in a joint team, and also to define good and clear objectives for this whole system. In this way, we will be able to have a livable and viable area, and I suppose that it will be also equitable between rural and urban areas. Thank you very much.